the tree of wisdom, whose leaves hold forth the healing of the nations. Tree of all knowledge, tree of compassion, tree of all beauty. Its name is Jesus, name that says our Savior. Here on its branches, see the scars of suffering. See there in the tendrils of our human selfhood, tree on its life blood. Sonar tangled in its foliage, our greed is starved it, our despite has choked it. Yet look at life's grief that has destroyed it, nor fire consumed.
You'll excuse me if I appear to be tired tonight. It's been an exceptionally long day for me. These old bones hurt, and I have a bit of a headache. I suppose I must be getting too old to handle the sort of commotion I had in here today. Oh, but you don't want to listen to an old man complain. You see, this is my carpentry shop. Here's where I've spent the last 51 years of my life, and I can tell you, I've seen days to come and I've seen days go, but today is like one I never want to see again, ever. But before that, let me show you what I'm working on here. I'm planing a groove into this other beam of wood. You know the cross? Have you seen one? This is what the finished product will be once those two beams of wood are fitted and bound together with rope. Then the soldiers of the Roman army will take the cross and carry it just out of town to a hill they call the Place of the Skull. Believe me, this is just a fitting title for such a place. It gives me goose flesh just to mention it. The Place of the Skull is the location where criminals are executed. They're hung on a cross like this one for a torturous death by slow suffocation. I'd rather not talk about it if you don't mind. It's really gruesome. You're probably wondering then why it is I make these crosses if it makes me this upset. Good question. I probably don't have a good answer for you, but all I can say is I've been a carpenter all my life, and I'm just too old to fight. I've been chosen, you could say, commissioned by Roman military to make these crosses for them, to refuse. Well, I'm too old just to face the consequences. I come from a long line of carpenters. My father likes to tease my grandchildren. That would be my children's children. He tells them that our family's been in the carpentry trade since Noah. He tells them that Noah was the greatest carpenter who ever lived. My father loves to illustrate tales to the children about how large the ark was that Noah made. In fact, my father made a small model of the ark to use in his recreation of the story of the great flood. The great-grandchildren marvel at this story, just as my children's children did, as my children's did, as I did, and still do. holding up this model ark filled with all the animals he spent days. He spent days whittling. And then my father tells the story with such conviction. In the 600th year of Noah's life, in the second month, on the 17th day of the month, on that day all the fountains of the great deep burst forth, and the windows of the heavens were open. The rain fell each 40 days and 40 nights. Seems like just yesterday, when we were all so young, my father can no longer work with wood. He's quite unhappy with these crosses I make. He says they're a waste of God's good creation. Trees were made to provide shelter for God's creatures and to sustain life, he says. And now they are cut down and you turn them into instruments of death. Shame on you, my son. Well, some days I just shrug off his words and, you know, as the ranting of an old man. But today, well, today his words haunt me. Three soldiers barged into my tent early this morning demanding that I give them three crosses. I'd heard, too, that these two thieves would be executed this week, so I anticipated of their request that I'd already made two crosses. However, the soldiers laughingly told me they had sentenced to death another. They obviously were in need of three crosses instead of two, so they left here with two, saying they would return for the completed third cross in the morning. The one I'm working on is that third one. I asked them as they were leaving who the other thief was. They informed me that he wasn't a thief. He was a king. They said, King of the Jews. And then they laughed. Well, this sarcasm caught me off guard since I'm a Jew and I don't know of such a king among my people. I followed the soldiers out of the tent, imploring them to tell me the name of this king. Jesus of Nazareth, they told me as they ran off. As I turned to walk back in my shop, it dawned on me that I have heard of this Jesus of Nazareth. In fact, I've heard him speak in person, briefly, just a few days ago in Jerusalem. He was speaking to a crowd. I was passing through on my way to market when I heard this man quoting the words of our prophet Isaiah. I must admit that I have not been devout in my religious practice for a long time. But I remember the words of our, the prophets from my learnings as a child. This man was quoting Isaiah and saying strange things I did not understand. He said something like, whoever believes in me believes not in me, but in the one who sent me. And whoever sees me sees him who sent me. He said something about not coming to judge the world, but to save it. I inquired from someone in the crowd who this man was and who was speaking. They told me he's a rabbi, Jesus from Nazareth. It didn't strike me as odd, since there are many rabbis who roam the land teaching in the city as they go. But then, as I recall, this Jesus of Nazareth said something peculiar. He said he does not say the things he says on his own, but the Father who sent him commands him about what to say. Now, as I mentioned, what I heard from this Jesus was very brief, and I didn't quite understand it all. But something in his voice was quite powerful. I remember thinking how the power and authority with which he spoke seemed to make the prophet's words he used come alive. And the things he said following them, though I didn't understand their meaning, seemed to have the ring of truth in them. I heard the people in the crowd say that this Jesus is the one who's been healing the sick and forgiving the sins of people in the region. When I encountered Jesus earlier this week, it was the first time I'd ever heard of him. Now, this very morning, just a few days later, these soldiers are telling me that this Jesus who was speaking in the town center was going to be hung along two convicted thieves to suffer perhaps the most cruel death I could ever imagine. I'm a bit mystified. Could I have misjudged this wonderful speaker so greatly that he's really no more than a criminal? I remember the crowd in Jerusalem that day was very large, and I stood listening to them. I was caught up in the surge, which carried me to where I no longer was within hearing distance. I fought to get back to where I could hear, but it wasn't any use. The flow of people made it too difficult. I thought to myself that perhaps another opportunity would come for me to hear him. Yet that day I would have liked to linger for a while and listen to what this rabbi from Nazareth was saying. I felt at the time that if something in his voice seemed quite authentic, full of authority, I had a sense that what he was speaking was words I needed to hear. Listening to him that day reminded me I have been in search of something throughout my life which I know I have never really been able to find. Something missing. I'm probably too old now ever to find it, but I've always prayed for a chance. I feel like I might have had that chance if I could only have heard and perhaps understood more about what this Jesus had to say. I suppose I'm not going to get the chance now. As I mentioned earlier, a cloud of foreboding has been lingering over me all day. I feel a sense of regret that I will not have the opportunity to hear the words and teachings of the Rabbi Jesus. He will be executed, crucified for a crime that I don't know anything about. And what's more, he'll hang on a cross that I made with my own hands. So, you understand my sense of remorse is great. My father's admonition over this cross-making business has gotten me quite disturbed. So, particularly since I don't know it will be on this one that the Rabbi Jesus will hang, have I made a grave mistake by agreeing to make these crosses? This cross? His message seemed to be very powerful, and if what they say about his healing and forgiveness is true, am I now to be responsible for its termination? Is my cross to be the end of Jesus? God help me.
To dark Gethsemane, all who feel the tempter's power, your Redeemer's conflict see, watch him with one bitter hour. Turn not from his griefs away, learn from Jesus Christ to pray. Follow to the judgment hall, view the Lord of life to reign. Oh, the wormwood and the gall, God's own pangs his soul sustain. Shun not suffering, shame, or loss, learn from him to bear the cross. Calvary's mournful mountain climb, there adoring at his feet. Mark that miracle of time, God's own sacrifice complete. It is finished, hear him cry, learn from Jesus Christ to die. Thank you. and give thanks with a grateful heart. Give thanks to the Holy One. Give thanks because He's given Jesus Christ His Son. And give thanks with a grateful heart. Give thanks to the Holy One. Give thanks because He's given Jesus Christ His Son. And now let the weak say I am strong. Let the poor say I am rich. Because of what the Lord has done for us. And now let the weak say I am strong. Let the poor say I am rich. Because of what the Lord has done for us. Give thanks.
Lord God, maker of all things, we give thanks for those who, like your sons, shape wood for tools, for homes, and into crosses. That is our mark of faith. Help us to use forests and woodlands responsibly so that generations to come may have places of rest and clean air to breathe. We pray for those who are out of work or whose pay and hours have been reduced. We pray for those whose skills cannot be put to use due to injury and for all those suffering in body, mind, or spirit. We pray for St. John and its ministries, for its church council and staff, for our Belleville and Austin County, for Texas and the United States. We give thanks that your son took a sign of execution and torture and made it into a sign of hope and resurrection. Help us to be sources of hope for those who feel hopeless. For this and for everything else, you see what we need, dear God. Pray in the name of Jesus, our Lord, who's taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Lord bless and keep you. May he make his face shine down upon you. May the Lord look with favor upon you and give you peace. Amen.
Shelter of the Lord, who abide in the shadow for life, and say to the Lord, my refuge, my rock, in whom I trust, and he will raise you up on eagle's wings, bear you on the breath of dawn, make you to shine like the sun. His hand. The snare of the fowler will never capture you, and famine will bring you no fear. And under God's wings, your refuge, with faithfulness, your shield, and he will raise you up on eagle's wings. Bear you on the breath of dawn, make you to shine like the sun, and hold you in the palm of his hand. though thousands fall about you, near it you shall not come. And he will raise you up on eagle's wings, bear you on the breath of dawn, make you to shine like the sun, and hold you in the palm of his hand. For to the angels God's given a command to guard you in all of your ways. Upon their hands they will bear you up, lest you dash your foot against the stone. And he will raise you up on eagle's wings, bear you on the breath of dawn, make you to shine like the sun, and hold you in the palm of his hand. And hold you in the palm of his hand.
Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.